So the rest of section 9-3 deals with a hodgepodge of several different topics related to characteristics of TTL circuits. First of all, power dissipation. This is very important because we want to know how much power is being dissipated by this IC. Power is turned, it gets turned into heat, and heat inside a cabinet or on a printed circuit board can cause problems. So we want to watch the total power dissipation. And basically, to determine the power dissipation, we use this formula for power is equal to the volts times the amps. Which volts and which amps? Well, the power supply voltage, VCC, and the amps is the average amps flowing out of the power supply lead. Now, when the output of a gate is high, it draws ICCH, and when it's low, it draws ICCL. So we really need to look up these two values, and we're just going to take an average of these because we'll have to assume that half the time it's high, half the time it's low. So for example, 9.3, for example, 7402 had these two specs, 14 milli and 8 milli for their current. So we just took the average down here of those two times the 5 volts. So the total power dissipation of a 7402 NOR gate is about 55 milliwatts using this equation. The next topic in the section deals with open collector outputs. With an open collector output, you take the totem pole Q3 transistor with the 130 and the D3 and you remove it. Now, when the circuit produces a low output, Q4 will be shorted and the output will go to ground just like it would with a regular gate. However, for the high condition, rather than having Q3 become a short and apply the VCC down to the output goes into a new state called the float state. This allows us to tie many outputs together to a common point because otherwise you wouldn't be able to do that. If you ever tie two gates together and one was producing a high and one was producing a low, you would burn out one of the gates because there's a conflict. 5 volts from one gate, 0 from the other, with no resistance between them, you would have an excessive amount of current and burn out the gate. So this is where you use open collector outputs. Now with CMOS, it's called open drain outputs. It's the same deal. They have a complementary setup on their output also, and it's called the open drain output. So with this open collector output, the truth table becomes, if it's a NAND gate, if you have a low low, a regular NAND would give you a 1 because the Q3 would be shorted and the VCC would be allowed to travel to the V output point. But in this gate, since these are removed, it floats. So anytime it was going to be a high, the output floats instead. And anytime it was going to be low, the Q4 will do its short to ground and that will become a 0. Now, if the output is floating, we have a problem. We have to use a pull-up resistor to make a normally floating point look high. So here's an open collector gate. Sometimes just the letters OC afterwards will distinguish that as an open collector gate. With a pull-up resistor, let's see what happens. When the Q4 is outputting a low because it's a short, that's everything's fine. The output would be 0. You will have some current from the 5K down through the from the 5 volts down through the 10K into ground, but that's okay. In fact, the current would be 5 volts divided by 10K, which is a half a milliamp, no big deal. Now, when the Q4 is off, the output normally would be floating. In a floating output, you wouldn't know what to do with it. Floating just means it's not connected to anything, because if this is an open circuit and you didn't have this pull up here, this would just be a piece of wire floating in space, meaning float condition. However, with a pull up resistor, the 10K pull up makes the otherwise floating output look high because there's very little current going out into the next gate. So very little current through a 10K produces no drop. So you got 5 minus a very slight drop gives you about 5. That's an approximate symbol. It should be about, 4.9, 4.8. So again, the pull-up resistor is used on open collector and open drain circuits to make a normally floating point look high. So in figure 915A, I'm showing the 7405, which is a hex open collector inverter circuit. So these outputs will float when they're supposed to be high. So if you had a low here, this would be floating. A low here, this would be floating. That's why the equation is written this way. The output at X is high if we have a low A and a low B and a low C and so on. So if all of these are low, 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 these will be flow, 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 and the pull-up resistor makes a normally floating point look high. Here's a note. The outputs can never be connected together like this unless they are an open collector gate. If we use the regular 7404, if one of these was high and one of these was low, you'd have a direct short and somebody would burn out. And in figure B, I'm showing the same circuit. This is an equivalent figure B shown as in the AND gate representation, because this equation says X is high if I have a low and a low and a low and a low. Isn't that what this circuit says? X is high if I have a low and a low and a low and so on. So this is the AND gate method of doing it. And here's the NOR gate representation. Basically what you do is bubble push. Remember how to bubble push from chapter 5? You change the gate. If it's an AND, you change it to an OR, and you take bubbles wherever they were and you push them to the opposite end. So if the bubbles are on the input, you put it at the output, and here it is. The bubbles are removed, the ANDs change to an OR, and you put a bubble at the output. So depending on what your circuit logic you're trying to do, you could draw this circuit either shown as shown in figure A or B or C. They all operate exactly the same. So now in example 9-4, we're using the bubble pushing technique again to show that the output at this point of this open collector is the same as a bubble with an AND. So the output at X is high if I have not A and not B, and this is wired ANDing, it's called, the function of this, which is not C or not D, and EF. And the way I got these was I just took this bubble, put it on the front end, changed the OR to an AND, and so on all the way down. Here is the final equation down near the bottom of the page. Something else we have to think about is the disposition of unused inputs and unused gates. So if you have an open input, it tends to degrade because the AC noise that may be present in the circuit may be picked up on a floating input. So you got to do something with the unused input. So let's say we had a 3-input AND gate. Well, if you're only using 2 of the inputs, what do you do with the third? If it's a NAND, you got to tie the third input high or the other 2 would be ignored. And if it's an AND, you would have to tie the third input high also. So unused inputs on ANDs and NANDs should be tied high. Unused inputs on OR should be tied, ORs and NORs should be tied to ground or to a low. So an example of this would be a 3-input AND gate that is only using 2 of its inputs. Make sure you do take care of that third input. Don't just assume it's going to assume a high or assume a low. If you don't connect it, you got to drive it either high or low. The other thing is unused gates on an IC should be forced into a high condition to reduce the ICC. Remember the ICCH was a little bit less than ICCL? So you want the gate that's unused to be forced into a high condition to reduce that supply current, which reduces the power dissipation. So to do this, if you have AND or OR inputs, you want to take those and make them hot. Because if you have an AND gate, you tie both inputs high-high, you would get a high-out. If you had an OR gate, both inputs high-high, you'd get a high-out. So that takes those gates and reduces their power dissipation. Also, if you have NANDs and NORs or inverters, you want to tie those low to make their outputs high. An example is if you had a quad NOR, if you're only using 3 of the NOR gates, take care of that fourth one. Make sure it's forced high and its output is forced high. And finally, remember we talked about power supply decoupling with a capacitor. Remember the totem pole output. Occasionally the transistors will actually overlap, so the Q3, Q4 may, for a short duration, be both on at the same time. You get a huge spike, which which has a huge draw on the VCC power supply, dropping the voltage to a lower than 5 volt level, which is undesirable. So what you can do is put capacitors on the VCC to ground right next to the VCC pin. You'll see this a lot on circuit boards. You'll see a small, usually used a tantalum, like a 0.1 microfarad or a 0.01 microfarad, right next to the VCC and place it from there to ground. That way, if the VCC line tries to spike low, the capacitor dumps its charge to fulfill the need to maintain a constant VCC power supply. So that pretty much takes care of the section 9-3. And like I said, make sure you do those problems at the end of the chapter. That's it for now.